Since Einstein blessed us with his general relativity theory, we started to have a glimmer of hope. He opened a new frontier in astrophysics and in science in general. Perhaps Einstein's most famous rule is, nothing can travel faster than light. And it seems to ensure that exploration of even the local part of our galaxy would be implausible. But he also showed us that space and time can be curved, that space and time can be warped. That's how some physics fans and sci-fi writers started to think about traveling in space at superluminal, that means faster than light, velocities. That's how the warp drive idea was born. Scientists have always been fascinated by this topic, and that's how we soon had some math to describe a hypothetical warp drive. It went pretty much like this. They asked themselves, if we want to travel faster than light, what do we need? And they started collecting solutions from Einstein's field equations in order to solve for superluminal speeds. One of the most famous solutions was Alcubierre's warp drive solution, and it made us dream of faster-than-light travel throughout the years. Just recently, a paper came out that discussed some solutions to Alcubierre's warp drive. Follow me in this video to get to know more about warp drive, how it works, and about new frontiers of space traveling. New warp drive possibilities. In 1915, Albert Einstein's general theory of relativity revealed that the fabric of space and time is mutable and dynamic. It can, in fact, be warped. Let's be clear, one can't travel faster than the speed of light, but there is no speed limit for the fabric of space itself. What does this mean? It means that one could possibly sit in a comfortable sort of bubble, drinking his tea perfectly still, and let the space-time move faster than light. You got it right. The bubble would be perfectly still. The space-time would do all the work. In certain circumstances, in fact, we can think of space itself as moving, and there is no limit to the relative motion of two patches of space, and so objects in those patches could have superluminal speeds relative to each other. You want one example of this? Black holes. Inside black holes, we can think of space as flowing downward faster than light. The warp drive takes advantage of this by accelerating a patch of space relative to its surroundings. Objects in that warp bubble move with that patch without themselves ever feeling any acceleration. This is what the Alcubierre drive is supposed to do. The idea is very simple. One should quickly expand the space behind the spaceship and at the same time should contract the space ahead of it. In other words, the spaceship stops in a bubble of space, but this bubble moves quickly in the universe due to contraction and the expansion of the surrounding space. It is pretty much the same thing that happens when a surfer rides a wave. The board does not move relative to the water, but the wave pushes the board forward. In short, the spaceship is not moving faster than the speed of light in its local reference frame. But since the space around the bubble is distorted, it would come to its destination sooner than light would take traveling in normal conditions. Alcubierre, inspired by Star Trek, published an article in which he describes the way which, hypothetically, such a thing could be obtained, starting from Einstein's equations. The article became very popular, especially among fans of science fiction. In fact, nowadays we talk about the Alcubierre warp drive. However, Alcubierre did not really invent a new engine. He just proved that the relativity equations allow, in theory, to describe a geometry of space-time that can allow us to travel faster than light. But what kind of physical conditions should be fulfilled in order to shift from mathematics to physical reality? Since the curvature of space is caused by matter distribution, we must ask ourselves what kind of matter we would need to run such a warp drive. The answer is, we need a kind of matter with negative mass. General relativity works by solving Einstein's field equations. Here they are. Einstein's equations then tell you that the distribution of different types of energy determines the curvature, and the curvature in return determines how the distribution of the stress energy changes. The way you normally solve these equations is to use a distribution of energies and masses at some initial time. Then you can calculate what the curvature is at an initial time, and you can calculate how the energies and masses will move around and how the curvature changes with that. So this is what physicists usually mean by a solution of general relativity. It is a solution for the distribution of mass and energy. But you can instead take any space-time, put it into the left side of Einstein's equations, and then the equations will tell you what the distribution of mass and energy would have to be to create that space-time. This space-time, on a purely technical level, will then indeed be solutions to the equations for whatever stress-energy tensor you get. The problem is that in this case, the energy distribution which is required to get a particular space-time is in general entirely unphysical. And that's the problem with the Alcubierre drive. It is a solution to general relativity, but in and by itself, this is a completely meaningless statement. Any space-time will solve the equations of general relativity provided you assume that you have a suitable distribution of masses and energies to create it. The real question is therefore not whether space-time solves Einstein's equations, but whether the distribution of mass and energy required to make the solution to the equations is physically reasonable so that there could be a drive. This is pretty much a common obstacle in physics problem solving or the development of a theory. Mathematics tells you which solution is acceptable in the realm of math, but a physicist can accept only solutions that fit in the real world. So, is there a physically reasonable distribution of mass and energy in order to create a warp drive? The answer is probably no. First, as we already said, it requires negative energy. Second, it requires a huge amount of negative energy. Third, the energy is not conserved. We can summarize this by saying that it requires a negative energy density, which should be impossible except perhaps on the tiniest quantum scales. Sometimes people talk about the drive requiring negative mass, also called exotic matter. And yeah, that would do the trick too, and is also probably impossible. So that sounds like a deal breaker. The other minor hiccup is that Alcubierre's original field required more energy than is contained in all the matter in the visible universe to move a moderate-sized starship. Subsequent studies improved on Alcubierre's warp design and brought down the energy requirement to less insane levels, although they typically remain somewhat insane. But the requirement of exotic matter didn't go away, and in fact, subsequent studies demonstrated that any superluminal warp drive must use negative energy densities. Before we dive into the new published paper, and if you like this video, we strongly recommend you to watch our previous video about warp speed.
If you'd like to help improve the quality of our content, please check us out on Patreon. We would like to say a big thank you to all those who show their support.
So, we said there is a new paper treating the warp drive subject. This paper is titled Introducing Physical Warp Drives, and it was written by Alexei Bobrik and Gianni Martiri. In this paper, Bobrik and Martiri described the geometry of a general warp drive space-time. As we said earlier, the warp drive geometry is basically a bubble. I think it would be very fun to move across the universe in a bubble. The bubble has an inside region which the authors call the passenger area. In the passenger area, space-time is flat, so there are no gravitational forces. Then the warp drive has a wall of some sort of material that surrounds the passenger area as well as an outside region. This outside region is the key to warped space-time. It has the gravitational field of the warp drive itself, but the gravitational field falls off, and in the far distance one has a normal, flat space-time. What makes this fairly general construction a warp drive is that the passage of time inside of the passenger area can be different from that outside. This is exactly what we need in order to follow Einstein's rule, nothing moves faster than light. I mean, we are sitting in our bubble, and then the space-time is curved, and it, not us, moves faster than light. So you keep moving normally in the bubble, but then you move the bubble itself superluminally, as explained earlier. The real question here is, what does the wall of the passenger area have to be made of? In fact, we have to ask ourselves, is this a physically possible distribution of mass and energy? That is, a physically possible solution. Bobrick and Martire explain that if you want superluminal motion, you need negative energy densities. If you want acceleration, you need to feed energy and momentum into the system. This is something impossible to achieve at the moment. We simply don't know how to do that, and also we can say it is probably impossible. This paper is a very important one because it really demystifies warp drives. Of course, now it might seem that we are less excited than before because really, it says that we still don't know how to accelerate to superluminal speeds. But if you think more about it, you will notice that as it closes some doors, it opens up a lot more possibilities. In fact, we now have a much better mathematical basis to study warp drives. For example, studying the math, Bobrick and Martire showed that for the Alcubierre drive, you can decrease the amount of energy by seating passengers next to each other instead of behind each other, because the amount of energy required depends on the shape of the bubble. In particular, the flatter it is in the direction of travel, the less energy you need for other warp drives. And maybe there are a lot of other geometries that may work better. This is the kind of question you can really only address if you have the mathematics in place. Another exciting thing is that while it may look now like you can't do superluminal warp drives, this is only correct if general relativity is correct, and maybe it's not. We know that general relativity is the actual best theory we have to describe the universe and how it works, but we have a lot of problems and a lot of questions to answer. Astrophysicists have introduced dark matter and dark energy to explain what they observe, but it is also possible that general relativity is ultimately not the correct theory for space-time. Could this mean something for warp drives? Could it have implications for them? We really don't know, but now we have the mathematics to study this question. As you can see, it turns out that, as Sabine Hossenfelder said, scientific research is a double-edged sword. Sometimes, if you look closely at a really exciting idea, it turns out to be not so exciting, and maybe you'd rather not have known. But I think the only way to make progress is to not be afraid of learning more. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find this content interesting? Do you think it will be possible to build and use a warp drive? Do you have any questions for us? Let us know in the comments below. See you next time on the channel.